Now, using the same producer as say groups like the Knack and that, and I mean Mike Chapman's been around for a long while, having a lot of influence on the English charts, especially like with Suzi Quatro and Smokey and, yeah. and so on and so on and so on, Chapman and Chim. How much influence do you have on you when you both sort of, you know, started working together? I mean, how much of a help was he as a producer?
Well, he was very helpful, but his influence is more in showing us how to work.
Yeah.
More than any direct musical influence, I would think. You know, he really didn't change anything around too much. The arrangements, some of the arrangements are intact from the way we did them. You know, a lot of the songs on Sunday Girl, for example, was just the way I wrote it. You know, there wasn't any changes in that.
He brought about a more sort of professional attitude, which is, you go along, you have to develop no matter what you do. You know, you have to be professional at it.
As far as the Parallel Lines album, you had so many sort of different singles. I mean, like, did you have much say in what records were going to be released, or was it just left to really the markets and the companies?
The companies, pretty much.
Yeah, it was pretty much the licensees.
We just wanted to hold up. We didn't want Heart of Glass to be the first single off the album. Like, we released two in America before that, which totally didn't do anything at all. So Heart of Glass came out, and that really helped us. That was a big help to us in America.
Did you get frightened at being referred to with a disco image in just in that time?
Oh, no, not at all.
No?
Not at all.
It got us in the Studio 54. Could never get in before that record. It increased our chicness, you know? Like, we all of a sudden we became, like, more chic on a trendy sort of hairdresser level.
How do you structure it when you're going to recording? Do you do...
Well, we try to make everything different. I mean, that's one of the... All the people who we admire, like Bowie and Stones and stuff, I mean, that's one of their trademarks, has always been a lot of diversity in their work, you know?
Yeah.
Our critics have always said that we were, a 60s group.
Right.
And not just because of having a girl singer, but because of us being very diversified and having a lot of different sounds and a very singles kind of album outlook.
You've obviously saw a lot of groups while you were in Australia, because you've been asking about this group and that group and that.
Yeah.
Obviously, you did get around a lot, did you? And
oh,
see.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were there for a long time.
6 weeks.
Yeah.
So we got to really see what was happening.
Believe me, did we get around.
What did you think, actually, honestly, of Australian, groups from Australia? I
liked a lot of the groups, because a lot of them are so unspoiled, because they don't have all these heavy influences and heavy things they have to live up to, you know, being... You know, it's a lot different.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, my idea of like Australian groups and particularly Japanese groups, they have nothing in common with each other except that they both are rock and roll audiences. But taking the idea of having some kind of a native culture, you know, like I mean, our influences are from, you know, like the African rhythms and stuff that influenced American rock and roll, taking from like the Aboriginal music and forming it into some kind of Australian native kind of rock and roll culture is really exciting and is really like an obvious thing to me. And also with the Japanese, because the Japanese is very industrial culture, plus they have all these weird sounds, and Japanese ethnic music is so beautiful and so eerie, and bringing that into rock and roll, I mean, it's just like, it could be very exciting, you know, and all these things should be developed.